have a story I want to just share that kind of relates to what I'm preaching on this morning there. There was a call to worship that had just gone out at a particular church. It was more of a traditional church, that has a more traditional style of worship. And it was Easter Sunday morning, and it was a Texas-type church. So it was a southern, church, but still had tradition and stuff that they liked in their worship. The choir of this church, because it was a rather large church, they decided to have a processional down the center aisle. And since it was Easter, they were going to sing "Up from the Grave He Arose" as they marched in procession down the aisle singing the song. And it went on like perfect with the steps and everything marching. But the last woman that was in the line happened to be wearing shoes with very slender heels, and she stepped on the grating cover of the hot air vent that happened to be also in the center of the aisle. And ladies, you know what happens when something like that takes place. Her shoe got stuck firmly in that grate, but she was sharp. Without missing a step, she slipped her foot out of that shoe and continued marching with a limp, because the other shoe was still on, right on down the aisle without causing a scene or anything, and everything was going wonderful. Well, the rest of the procession continued because the men came next, and the first man behind her spotted the situation, saw the shoe stuck in the grate, and so without losing a step himself, he reached down as he walked over it, grabbed the shoe, but the grate stuck to the shoe, and up from the floor came the shoe and the grate. But he kept on marching in perfect precision with the music as they continued singing on down the road. Well, finally, though, the last guy in the line, he was oblivious, did not see what was going on, and when he came to that spot, he fell right through the floor. Out of sight. I mean, this guy was just gone. And so the service, continued on, with that point. The song finally ended. The choir sang the final part of it. Alleluia, Christ arose. And just as it came to a quiet hush, they heard this voice saying, "I hope you're all out of the way, because I'm coming out now." And a little girl happened to be at the aisle, kind of said, "Come on, Jesus, we'll stay out of the way." I don't know if the devil said that on Easter Sunday morning, because he was not prepared for the resurrection to take place. But aren't you glad that he didn't stay down there? He arose and he came, and all the obstacles that stood in his way got out of his way, because you can't keep the Son of God down like that. He has life and all power in heaven and earth, and all authority is given to him. And when he decided to return from the dead and he arose, he conquered sin. The stone was rolled away, and he arose victorious, defeating not only sin and the devil, but every demonic power that was arrayed against him. That's the power of the risen Christ that we serve. Well, this morning I'm finishing up, Lord willing, a small series of messages I've been preaching, and the theme has been about the crowns we will wear. And we actually sang a hymn last week talking about we shall wear a crown. How many of you are looking forward to wearing a crown one day in heaven that God's going to give us? So I've been looking at some of those crowns that the Bible has been mentioning. And just to kind of review for a few seconds, the first crown that I talked about was the crown of rejoicing. And that crown speaks to those who get to rejoice in the Lord with the souls that have come into God because of our testimony. How many know that there's going to be rejoicing in heaven? And so there's a crown of rejoicing that God has for his faithful. And then we also looked at what I call the crown of eternal righteousness, that God is going to give us an everlasting crown that will not fade. And there is a crown of righteousness that is promised to the saints of God who overcome and who have faith in Christ and receive his righteousness. How many know you're not good enough to make it to heaven on your own? You're not. No matter how good you are, no matter how perfect you think you are, you cannot get to heaven based upon your own righteousness. You need the righteousness that God gives. And aren't you glad Jesus made that possible for us? So I'll talk about that in a little bit. Well, all of these crowns that I've preached about or mentioned and out in different scriptures, they are more like spiritual crowns, but I think some of them are kind of even more than just spiritual. They're literal. I think we will wear crowns. That's just kind of what I see. But the ones I want to be talking about today came to us because Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead. Matter of fact, all of them come to us because of Christ's death and his resurrection. So this morning, I want to preach about the crown of thorns and life. There is a crown of thorns that Jesus wore when he hung on the cross, but because of the crown of thorns that he wore, we will wear a crown of life. And that's what the Bible indicates, that's what the Bible speaks to, that's what the Bible tells us about, and I rejoice with that. So I need to start my message this morning by reading from John chapter 19 about the death of Christ, and this is what the Bible says. You can turn there in your Bibles. We also have it on the overhead behind me. It says, so when Pilate took Jesus and scourged him, all the soldiers twisted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe, and they said, Hail, King of the Jews! And they struck him with their hands. Then go down to verse 16. It says, then he delivered him to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, led him away, and he, bearing his cross, went out to a place called the Place of the Skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him, and two others with him, one on either side, and Jesus in the center. Hallelujah. Could we pray for a moment? Father, I ask for your blessing this morning on your word. I ask for your anointing to deliver a message that you've laid on my heart. Speak to us, Lord God. Give us insight. Open our eyes to know the truth. And may the truth be the word of God that sets us free. We thank you this morning and praise you because we celebrate this morning that Jesus lives. And because he lives, we live also. In your name I pray. Amen. This story of the crucifixion of Christ is one of the most powerful, I believe, accounts of divine love that has stood the test of time throughout all of human history. Despite the worst of human cruelty, despite the worst of humanity's hatred, despite the worst of people's racism and even corrupt politics, it's all found in this simple story of the crucifixion of Christ. You'll find all of that there. Despite the worst in humanity, and how do you know humanity has a dark side to it? The very worst of humanity came out at the time when they crucified Jesus. But let's face it, he deserved none of that. He came to love, he came to heal, he came to serve, he came to heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out demons, bless people, touch people's lives, make them better, and they killed him despite all that he did. 1 week earlier, on Palm Sunday that we celebrated last week, they were crying, you know, Hosanna, Hosanna, and welcoming Jesus into their city and waving palm branches. And then 1 week later, the same crowd is crying out, Crucify him. So it brought out the worst of humanity. But if you read the Gospels, you also know this. Jesus said that no man is taking my life from me. I willingly lay it down. That's what he tells us. He willingly gave his life. People were the tool by which it happened, but Jesus willingly gave his life, and he did it to fulfill the plan of God. Aren't you glad God's got a plan? Amen. God's got a plan. It's been laid in motion ever since, even the beginning of creation itself. God knew what was going to happen. God foreordained what he was going to do. He had a plan, and he had a person to carry out that plan, and the person was himself, Jesus, the divine Son of God. And so I thank God for that. He could have called, he said himself, 12 legions of angels to deliver him from that cross, to save him from that suffering and from that death, to rescue him at any time during the events of all that took place, during the time when he was arrested, during the time that they tortured him and they scourged, and that scourge means they beat him and whipped him with whips and struck him and pulled his beard out and put the crown of thorns that I'm specifically preaching about this morning on his head. At any point in that process, even as they traveled to the cross and he carried that heavy wooden beam, even as they nailed him to the cross and they hung there for several hours, at any point he could have called without a cell phone on 12 legions of angels that would have showed up and instantly put down every enemy, delivered him from that death, and set him free and established God's kingdom on the earth at that point. But he did not. He delayed that. Now, one day that will happen. He will come again, and he's coming with power and angels, and will be part of that army, and he will set up his kingdom on this earth, but we await for the king to come before that happens. Till now, it's a spiritual kingdom that people enter into by faith that we have a joy to know. So Jesus, by doing this, demonstrated the true love of God for humanity. He was willing to sacrifice himself so that even the worst of sinners could be saved from the judgment of hell's fire. Understand that. That was the whole reason for this terrible form of torture that he endured. He wanted to show the ultimate sacrifice of his love for people that did not even deserve it. Even the very people that crucified him. You know what he said? Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Can you imagine that? The very people that are doing the worst things to him, he cries out, forgive them, because they don't know really what's going on, because Jesus loves people. But he does give people a free will. He lets you do what you want to do, and you'll face the consequences of those decisions. In the portion of John's account that we just read, the Roman governor named Pilate had Jesus beaten and scourged, which means they whipped him with a whip that was laced with pieces of bone and iron, so that by the time they finished this scourging and the beating and everything that they else did to abuse him, you could not usually recognize the person as even being a human being. That's the torture level. Matter of fact, most people died from the scourging that the Romans did before they even got to be crucified. But nevertheless, he survived through all of this. And I've got a little PowerPoint here to illustrate what I want to show you. Since the Roman soldiers knew that Jesus was going to be charged with the crime of claiming to be a king, you know what they did? The Bible says they made a crown of thorns. And that picture best illustrates what it possibly looked like on his head. We don't know exactly what Jesus looked like, but that's a good illustration of it. Why did they put that crown of thorns on his head? Because they heard that from the trial, that was the charge that was being leveled against him. That was why, officially, they were crucifying him, because he was claiming to be a king. And you know what? He was a king. But his kingdom was not of this world at that point. And he told Pilate that. He said, my kingdom is not of this world. Otherwise, my servants would fight and do the power of God and the angels. He could have defeated all of Rome. How many know you can't stand against God and win? If God's going to do something, God's going to do it. And all of man and all of Satan and everything else cannot oppose that. But that was not God's time. And so he willingly submitted to that. They pressed that crown of thorns on his head. They laughed and jeered. They mocked at him. They cried out, hail, King of the Jews, in derision, and thought he was a fool. But you know what? 3 days later, he showed them who the real fools were. He showed them who the real fools were. You see, after they finished that mocking, whipping, and torturing him, then they led him away to the place called Calvary, Golgotha, where they crucified him on the cross. And there were two thieves also crucified there, one on either side, so that he was in the middle with all that was going on there. And then they did something else. They placed this plaque above his head. Pilate ordered this. And on that plaque, and the picture behind me illustrates that, there was the charge that he was being crucified for. He was accused because he said he was the king of the Jews. That upset the Jews because they didn't want that up there. So they went back to Pilate later, if you know the story, and said, why don't you add something to that? Say that he said he was the king of the Jews. And Pilate said, no, what I've written, I've written. And you know, sometimes God even works through things like that to show the truth. He was the king of the Jews. He was their Messiah, like we sang earlier. But they rejected him. And they suffer the consequences of that. Jesus hung there for hours in agony, wearing that crown of thorns on his head. And those two thieves that were crucified with him, one mocked him, one laughed at him, one derided him. But the other, after he did a little bit of mocking, he came to realize, you know, there's something different about this man. And he began to realize he really is maybe the Son of God. And so he asked me, he said, Lord, when you come into your kingdom, would you remember me? It was his cry for mercy. And the amazing thing is Jesus, the Bible tells us, looked at him and said, this day you will be with me in paradise. How many know that if you turn to God with a sincere heart and cry out to him, he will hear your cry, and Jesus welcomed him into the kingdom. One man went to hell, the other man went to heaven. Thank God for the promise that God gives to those who turn to him. That crown of thorns and the blood that Jesus shed on that cross when he died, it purchased our redemption. It purchased our salvation. It purchased the forgiveness of our sins because he fulfilled everything and became our Savior. He gave his life so that we might have eternal life. Why? Because the Bible tells us that the consequences of sin is death, separation from God. And God cannot excuse that. If he did, he would not be God, because I mean, no, God keeps his word. And so God told Adam and Eve, the day that you sin, you will die. They died spiritually, separated for all of eternity. But the love of God compelled him to somehow save mankind from being separated from himself. So Jesus came. And when he was born into this world, he lived a sinless life. And as a man, therefore, he could die and take the punishment that we deserve for our sins and pay that penalty so that God's justice in heaven was satisfied and we could be forgiven. He took what you deserved. How many are glad Jesus took what we deserved? He took that upon himself. And so now God can forgive those who will come to him through Jesus. And that's how we receive that this morning. You know, crowns have always been a sign of authority and kingship. Charlemagne, whom historians say should be deserved to call the great king above all others, he wore an octagonal crown. Eight of the sides was a plaque of gold, and each plaque was studded with emeralds and sapphires and pearls, and the cost of that price of that crown was a king's ransom. That's how wealthy it was. Richard the Lionheart had a crown so heavy that it took two men standing beside him, one on either side, to hold his head up. Now that's how much gold and jewels he put inside of his crown. The crown that Queen Elizabeth wears is worth over $20 million. King Edward II owned 9 crowns, and that was kind of a record, we think, of any king that owned that many. Putting them all together, though, from all of Europe and all the archives of the East and all of them, they're just trinkets compared, though, to the crowns that Christ will wear. Because Revelation 19 says he wears many diadems, many crowns. He wears a crown of righteousness, a crown of glory, a crown of life, the crown of peace, and the crowns of power, all of these things. Among those crowns, there outshines one above all others. Pastor James Hewitt is the one who says all this. He says, it was not formed by skillful fingers of a silversmith. It was not created by the genius of a craftsman. It was put together hurriedly by the rough hands of Roman soldiers. It was not placed upon the wearer's head in pomp and ceremony, but in a hollow mockery of ridicule and blasphemy. It was a crown of thorns. It's an amazing thing, though, that crown belonged to me. Pastor Hewitt said, I deserve to wear that crown. I deserve to feel the thrust of the thorns. I deserve to feel the warm trickle of blood down upon my brow. I deserve the pain. He took my crown of thorns, but without compensation. He offers it to me instead, a crown of life. A crown, he said, that does not fade away. Aren't you glad this morning? Jesus took the crown of thorns for you so that you could have a crown of life. And that brings me to Matthew chapter 28, because I'm not just going to leave Jesus hanging on the cross and dead, but how many are glad he arose? Matthew 28 says it this way: Behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. The guards shook for fear and became like dead men. And the angel answered and said to the women, Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for, say it with me, he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. The words that that angel spoke at that time have resounded through all the earth ever since then. It's the glorious morning of his resurrection. He is risen. Powerful thing there. There is an influence that's going on in this world today of different traditions trying, I believe, somewhat to smother out the true meaning of Easter, the resurrection. But the true meanings of our treasured holidays, it seems, are being lost in society. They're being secularized. Anybody else notice that going on besides me? For example, due to the influence of the Easter Bunny, many children get confused over what Easter really is all about. There's a cartoon once called The Family Circle. I used to like reading that when I was younger. It says, two children have found their Easter baskets, and they were enjoying the candy. And one of them said, Who colored all these eggs? And their sister replied, The Easter Bunny. And the other kid said, Well, who gave all the jelly beans? It was the Easter Bunny. And the chocolate rabbit? It was the Easter Bunny. Obviously, there was nothing beyond the power of the Easter Bunny, at least to that small, impressionable child. And so the family then went on to church that morning, and the pastor said, They came to the tomb, saw the stone had been rolled away. Who could have done this? And the little girl stood up and said, It was the Easter Bunny. I mean, oh, it was not the Easter Bunny that rolled the stone away from that tomb. It was a powerful angel of God that rolled the stone away, because the Son of God, Jesus, was alive and came back from the dead, and he lives as a result of that. His dead body was no longer in the grave because he arose. He had defeated death because he had defeated the power of death. And you know what the power of death is? The Bible says it's sin. The whole reason we're dying and do die is because of sin. That's what God warned Adam and Eve. Matter of fact, death entered the human race because of the sin of Adam. And I got a picture that kind of contrasts Adam on the left side with that forbidden fruit, but you have other on the other side is Jesus. Matter of fact, Paul the Apostle, in writing the book of Romans, he contrasts the first Adam with the second Adam. The first Adam, he sinned and doomed all of humanity to death and separation from God. But he said the second Adam, who is Jesus, who is also called the Son of God, who is the only divine begotten Son of God, he came and through the redemption that he provided, he has delivered us from the power of death. He came to this earth, was born, lived a perfect life. And so therefore, his sacrifice satisfied God's justice. And I thank God for that. Because the crown of thorns that he again wore on his head became the means for which we receive a crown of life from God. And he will give that crown of life to those who have faith in the Lord Jesus, who have repented of their sins and surrendered their life to him, and who by faith have entered into the family of God. Can you say amen to that this morning? There's an old legend I just want to share with you briefly of a priest who found a branch of a thorn tree that was twisted around, and it really looked very authentic, like a crown of thorns. So he had this bright idea, being Easter, he decided that he would go lay it on the communion table on Good Friday as a symbol of the death of Christ. And the next morning, early on Easter, though, he remembered that he'd forgotten they'd put it there, and thinking it was not appropriate for the resurrection Sunday, he decided to run down to the church and take it off the altar, because he's not dead anymore, he's alive. But when he got there, the legend says he saw that it had blossomed with beautiful rosebuds. How many know that Jesus came alive? He lives. And because he lives, we have that faith, that life. I have one more story, a passage of scripture I want to read to you. It's Revelation chapter 2, verse 10. And this is what Jesus spoke to one of the churches. He said there very simply, "Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." So that's what I mentioned earlier, this crown of life. Jesus' crown of thorns, I believe, makes it possible for us to receive this crown of eternal life. This crown of life that God will give, it's actually eternal life itself. And that's why we need to have faith in Jesus. He makes it possible for us to have what God promised. Some of you probably know this, maybe new news to some of you, but one of our founding fathers of our nation, Thomas Jefferson, he was a great man. He helped frame the Constitution and contributed a lot to our society and our great nation today. But nevertheless, there's some problems with Thomas Jefferson. He was not a real believer in God like we are, and he just could not accept the miraculous in the Bible. He just couldn't accept that. He was not a man that believed in miracles. And so he actually made his own version of the Bible, and he edited out every miraculous reference, every healing, every miracle that is mentioned in the Bible. He cut it out, and it's a very thin Bible after he got a result of that. And the ending of the Gospels, you know, read a certain way, because all he could write about in the Gospels was the moral teachings of Jesus, because most of the Gospels talk about healings and miracles and people being raised from the dead and all these things taking place, and of course, what we're celebrating today, the resurrection. So the closing words of Jefferson's Bible are these: "There laid they Jesus and rolled a great stone at the mouth of the sepulcher and departed." And that's the ending of his gospel. I thank God that's not the way the story truly ended. How about you? That is not the way the story ended. Jesus arose from the dead and he lives today. So that if we put real faith in Christ, we can see how Jesus will change people's lives. And he will begin to heal the heart. He'll begin to deliver their soul. He'll begin to work inside of a person, transforming their life so that they can be the people that God intended for them to be and do great things in his name. I believe God has a plan and a purpose for all of our lives. And through the resurrection of Jesus, the power of God is available to make that plan a reality. How many are glad that God can take even that which is broken and fix it and bring it back to wholeness? And I'm talking about us. We need God's work inside of our lives. If Jesus Christ could rise again from the dead, then anything is possible. Do you believe that this morning? if he can arise from the dead, if he can conquer death, if he can conquer demons, if he can conquer Satan and all the fallen angels, then that means there is nothing too difficult for him. And greater is he now that's in you, the Bible says, than he that is in this world. All things are possible to him that believes, because the power of God is greater than whatever you may be facing. God is greater than all the things that come against us, that people do to us, that happen to us in life. And yes, life is tough, but aren't you glad we serve a greater God? He's the creator of all things. And you know what? When something goes wrong, he's the one we turn to in prayer, because he's the fixer. Now, we may not always get absolutely everything we want in life like we want it. I mean, that's a reality. But the good news is we have God's promise that he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And I have prayed and seen different times in my life where he has given strength to myself and others to endure what they're going through with victory and power and grace. And then I've also seen times where the power of God is manifested when God's people pray in faith, and they've seen God miraculously intervene to change circumstances, to do things that man said was impossible. We've got people sitting in this room this morning that should be dead right now, but because God answered prayer, they're still alive. They're still kicking the devil, and they're still giving God praise this morning. That's what God does. And all that is possible because he lives. He arose from the dead. The crown of thorns that he gave and wore became the means for us to wear a crown of life. It's a crown, like I preached on, that will never fade away, that won't pass, because the crowns that they used to award athletes in those days of old, I mentioned the other week when I was preaching, they were simple crowns made out of plants and bushes and leaves, and how do you know that deteriorates, that falls apart, and eventually you got nothing left. But the crown that God gives of eternal life will abide forever. And we get to rule and reign, and we get that crown of rejoicing in heaven. We get the crown of righteousness because he's made us righteous in the sight of God. And that brings me to one last scripture I'd like to read before I close. It's Revelation chapter 3, verse 11. Jesus said this, "Behold, I am," say it with me, "coming quickly." How many believe that this morning? "Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast to what you have, that no one takes what? Your crown." I'm coming quickly. So hold fast, stand strong, be firm is what that word means. Don't let anyone take your crown. You shall wear a crown, but you have to have faith until the end. You will wear a crown in heaven, but you have to keep your faith in Christ and stand fast for the Lord and live for God in the midst of this wicked, sinful, fallen world. Don't let anybody take your crown. Don't let any of your enemies push you into giving up and doing something and taking your crown. Don't let even your friends make you do something and lose your crown. What good does it do you to gain the whole world, Jesus said, and get everything you want in this life and still lose your soul? You can be the richest man in the world. You can wear some of those crowns that I preached about earlier and mentioned that kings wear. You know, that one guy's got a crown so heavy it takes two men to hold his head up. But what good does that do you in eternity? Because there's only one crown that's going to last forever. Be sure that you have that crown. Early Sunday morning, while it was still dark, the Bible tells us that Mary Magdalene came to the tomb, and she found the stone had already been rolled away from the entrance. She ran in, and then she ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the Bible says, whom Jesus loved. And she said, "They've taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and I don't know where they have put him." Peter and the other disciple, the Bible says, ran to the tomb to see, and the other disciple outran Peter because Peter was not in shape, and he got there first. And he stooped and looked in and saw the linen cloth laying over. But it was kind of a puzzle there. And then Simon Peter arrived, and he actually went on inside the tomb, and he also noticed the linen wrappings that were lying there. And that cloth that had covered Jesus' face and head was neatly folded up, laying on the side. Some of you may know this, but in order to understand the significance of a folded napkin there, you have to understand a little bit about the Hebrew tradition of their day. See, the folded napkin had to do something with a master and his servant at dinner time. And every Jewish boy knows this tradition. You see, when a servant set the dinner table for the master, he made sure that everything was exactly as the master wanted it. And then he would step away so the master could come and eat. And he stood in the background in case any of you was needed, but he didn't interfere at all. And when the table was furnished perfectly and he waited out of sight, he waited there until the master finished eating. But the servant would not dare approach or touch the table until the master was finished. And if the master was done eating, you know what he would do? He would rise from the table, wipe his finger in his mouth, and clean his beard. He would then wad up that napkin and toss it on the table and leave. But if he was just going to the bathroom and coming back to finish dinner, you know what he did? He would fold the napkin neatly and lay it beside his plate. So the servant knew he's coming back. How many know maybe that was what Jesus did when he arose from the dead? He neatly folded the napkin because he's coming back. It ain't over, folks. Just like the Bible verse on the picture behind me says, "Behold, I come quickly." He's coming back for us again. He arose from the dead. He spent 40 days on earth with his disciples, and the Bible says then he ascended unto heaven with the promise that he'll return in like manner. He's coming again, folks. As we wait for his return, don't let anyone take your crown. Don't let anyone take your crown. Keep faith in Christ, because the crown of thorns that he wore makes it possible for you and I to receive a crown of life. Hallelujah. Would you pray with me this morning?